I'm going to talk a little bit today about meditation and neurofeedback. I have been a meditation practitioner for 30 years and a psychotherapist in private practice for over 20 years. And 10 years ago, I brought NeurOptimal neurofeedback into my psychotherapy practice. So I get questions from people about, does neurofeedback replace meditation? Can I meditate while I'm doing neurofeedback? What's the difference between what the two do for yourself? So I thought I would take a little bit of time to talk about my own experience and observations with NeurOptimal neurofeedback and how it relates to meditation practice. So the first thing we want to acknowledge is that the motivation for pursuing either of those activities can be the same and it can be different. How it's similar is that we all know to some degree that our ability to stay in the present moment, whether that is with our pure attention or to have our emotions accurately reflect what's happening in the here and now, can be a challenge. We're very distracted. Our emotions sometimes feel like a roller coaster. You know, our thoughts steal our attention away, and we can, you know, be lost in a whole thread of thinking for long periods of time without realizing it. And so, in wanting to have more sense of control, whether it's just an ability to be in the present moment with our attention span, whether it's to be aware of our thinking and work more with our thinking, or whether it's to have more sense of calm and be able to be more emotionally centered and stable, you know, for all these reasons, we can reach for, tools in meditation or mindfulness, and we can also look to NeurOptimal neurofeedback. And so to talk a little bit about, you know, how they intersect and the main differences is that when we're doing a meditation practice, we're really setting our own intention. So for example, if we're doing mindfulness of breath, we're giving ourselves an instruction, which is, you know, to be still, to be focused, and to keep our attention on the cycle of the breath, whether it's the in-breath or the out-breath or, you know, counting breaths. But basically, we're giving with our prefrontal cortex, we're using that part of the brain to tell ourselves to stay with a present centeredness on what's happening. And then, of course, if we get distracted in thought, which happens, to return to that instruction and do that. So it's a very conscious process. Whereas NeurOptimal neurofeedback, what we're doing is we're actually working with the unconscious brain. So we're working much more to communicate directly with that unconscious part of the brain and to tell it, hey, I want you to see what you're doing unconsciously that are habitual patterns, whether those are emotional or mental patterns or with impulsivity, distractibility, or being able to be focused. So it's not about us doing something conscious. It's about really allowing this technology and using auditory feedback and interruptions in the feedback to cue that unconscious automatic brain to come into the present and gather data. And it's cued to do that in the moment that it's about to go in and perform some sort of function. So you can talk about NeurOptimal neurofeedback from a point of view of meditation as we're it's kind of like we're giving it that meditation gong to notice what you're doing that's habitually and sort of come back into the present, but that unconscious brain to do that. And then in terms of looking at what meditation and NeurOptimal neurofeedback do in terms of the stress response. So the stress response is that automatic functioning brain's fight, flight, freeze strategy that it employs automatically if it perceives imminent danger. And this can be a strong habit in some people, and how we, you know, talk about anxiety disorders or depression, you know, a big component is that stress response functioning of the brain. And so an interesting thing that I've observed is that when you do neurooptimal neurofeedback and you're coming out of that hypoarousal or the fight flight, so that's being, you know, speedy mind, irritable, anxious energy, and the brain registers this and shifts out of it through the process of the neurofeedback and into that state of regulation, or comes out of that hypoarousal of the, you know, the depressive, hopeless freeze response into regulation, that zone of regulation is really the ideal space in which to practice your conscious meditation, because that's a space where the brain is perceiving safety. So it's open, it's able to and wants to focus. And so often what I tell people is that neurooptimal neurofeedback creates the perfect conditions to then do a more conscious meditation practice, like panoramic awareness of Vipassana or the different mindfulness practices. So that's just a brief introduction to, you know, the relationship between meditation practice and neurooptimal neurofeedback.